So I have started recording. Now nobody should present the screen. I am presenting my screen over here. One second. Shohomodip has also joined. Now I'm presenting my screen. Okay. All of you can see me? All of you
yes,
can
ma'am.
See? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So here is my presentation. We will just have a quick revision on the whole topic first, and then we will move on to the chapter, okay? We would have a quick revision of whatever we have read in the previous class. So we have started with from the diary of Anne Frank, and we discussed various things about the background that was given in our textbook. But today we would also go through some objectives. What are the objectives? The things that we are going to learn while we are reading this chapter, and what we are going to learn after we have read and understood this chapter. So firstly, we are going to understand the life at the time of World War II. When Anne Frank is writing? Anne Frank is writing at the time of World War II. So obviously, it is very important to understand the time of Anne Frank when she is writing. Okay, so it becomes very important for us to understand the time of the World War II. What was the situation over there at that time? Okay, next point is we have to relate to the young mind of Anne. Being of your age, of the age of adolescence, as Anne is writing, you have to relate to her feelings, to her emotions, to her literary bent of mind. You have to relate to it. Number three is getting acquainted with various historic figures. I have told you one important name while we were dealing with this topic previous day, when I said that the twins were kept for different kind of experiments in concentration camp. I told you about a name who was called the Angel of Death. Can anybody just tell me that name? What was the name of that officer who was called the Angel of Death? Yes, Robert Mangala. It was Dr. Robert Mangala.
And the twins,
yes, Dr. Mangala. Dr. Mangala. And he was even called the Angel of Death because he was notoriously known for various experiments that he made in the concentration camp. Number three is we would get acquainted with the various historic figures. And number four, evaluate the literary value of such works. There are various kind of literary works and movies. We are going to talk about them also, about this topic, this World War topic, this topic of the suffering of these kind of people at that time. And number five is we are going to understand the importance of tolerance and acceptance in our life. It becomes very important for us to be tolerant. Nowadays, we have become very restless. We are angry with even little things. Even when we are not getting good food in the morning, we become intolerant. So acceptance and tolerance are getting removed from us. So we would learn about the importance of tolerance and acceptance from Anne's word. Okay, number six is write the various answers of this chapter. We would be able to write the various important answers from this chapter. Remember the newly learned words and use them afterwards. When afterwards you're going to write the creative writing section or letters, or even in normal conversation with your friends, with somebody outside, you try to use or put these words that you learn in your day-to-day life. Okay, that is why we learn new words. It is not only to use in your literature copy or in your answers. It is to use in every place. That is how it would be possible for you to be good English speaking person or English writing person, because you are using new words in it. The vocabulary becomes rich. Number eight is we would relate the story and the plot with real life situations. We are not residing in a time where there is world war, but we are residing in a time where there is a pandemic, where there are earthquakes, where there are depression, where there is online classes. We are not able to be even go to school to meet our friends. So this is also a very dangerous time period that we are going through, not less than any world war. Okay, now we would move on to the other things that we want to, that we need to remember while reading this chapter. Some important things or terms that we need to remember. First is World War II. Okay, what is World War II? Risham, would you please read this section where it is written World War II for us? Risham?
World War II is the general state to have begun on September 1, 1939 with the invasion of Poland by Germany and subsequent declaration of war on German by Germany by France and the United Kingdom.
So one second. So what are the three nation names that you're getting over here? First, you got Germany invaded, invasion of Poland by Germany. That is, Germany invaded Poland. So you get two names, Germany and Poland. And then you get France and UK who invades Germany. So three names you have already got. Okay, so and when it is starting in 1939. Okay, a state of total war emerged, directly involving more than 100 million people from more than 30 countries. That is why it was called a world war. Please put your microphone off. So that is why it was called the world war, because more than 100 million people were involved from more than 30 countries. Okay, there were industrial problem, economic problem. All of you are old enough to relate to this problem. War always brings up economic issues. Economic means there is not enough money to support even the citizens. So wars are always very dangerous, even for the soldiers and for the citizens. So this was the condition. World War II was the deadliest conflict in human history, marked by 70 to 85 million fatalities. Fatalities meant death. Fatal means something leading to death. F-A-T-A-L. Fatal means something that leads to death. Fatalities means death. 10 of millions of people died during the conflict due to the genocides. I said the meaning of this word genocide. Can anybody just tell me what is the meaning of genocide? I told you people in the previous class what is the meaning of genocide. Anybody remember what is the meaning of genocide? Okay, mass killing of people, or when there is a mass killing of people with some cause, it is called a genocide, including Holocaust. That is what I said, that Holocaust was a genocide. Okay, so this is the main thing that you want to remember, that you should remember while reading the story. That is the concept of World War II. And what was Holocaust? Holocaust was the, you can see over here, the definition is also given, was the World War II genocide of European Jews. Jew is a kind of particular religious people who always had a problem with the Christians. You can even refer to the famous literary works like The Merchant of Venice. When you're referring to Merchant of Venice, the cruel character has been depicted as a Jew. So always in the depiction of the people, the Christian people, we have a very cruel depiction of the Jews. They always had some religious issues among themselves. Okay, the Christians and the Jews. And so when Germany came to the power, what did I say when Abraham Lincoln said that every man is liberal until you give him power? That was what Abraham Lincoln said. So when Germany came to power, what did they do? They exercised their power and wanted to kill all the Jews, the mass killing of the Jews. And first, what did they do? First, they did not send them to any concentration camp. First, they made the Jews stay in ghetto. G-H-E-T-T-O-S, ghettos. G-H-E-T-T-O-S, ghettos. Ghettos are small colonies which were made for the Jews. So each and every month the ghettos were changed. Today you are living in the Ichhapur, and then again in the next month you're living in Palta, again in the next month you're living in Sodhpur. So all the families who were shifted in ghettos, every month they were shifted so that they cannot revolt, they cannot form a bonding, a unity. That is why they were kept in small colonies, and every month they were changed, the ghettos were changed. And then after that they started sending them to the concentration camp where they were killed. Now, Anne Frank is writing at a time when she is hiding out for 2 years almost in her father's, where was she hiding? I told you, in her father's, anybody office. Reply? Office, yes, office. In her father's office building. Yes, in her father's office building. Now, some points about Anne Frank's. The prose has been extracted. The prose that we have in our class has been extracted over here. You can even note them down in your notebook, English notebook, that the prose has been extracted from the original story, the novel, The Diary of a Young Girl by Anne Frank. What was the original name of the story? The Diary of a Young Girl by Anne Frank. What are the main characters in this little prose that we are going to, not the whole story, but the prose that we have, what are the main characters in it? It is Otto Frank, who is Anne Frank's father. There is Edith Frank, who is Anne Frank's mother. There is Margot Franz, who is Anne Frank's elder sister. There is a grandma with whom Anne Frank actually grew up. There is Mr. Kasing, who is the teacher. And Anne Frank herself, and obviously Kitty, the name that Anne Frank gives to her diary. What is the name that Anne Frank gives to her diary? The name is Kitty. He calls her diary Kitty because it is her friend. The original version of the story was written in Dutch, D-U-T-C-H. It's a language, okay? Later, it got published in many other languages, including English. It was written in 1942 when Anne was hiding and published after Anne's father came back from the concentration camp and found the diary in 1947. Written in 1942 and published in 1947. Published by whom? By Otto Frank, Anne Frank's a father, who was the only survivor after the concentration camp. Okay, so we are straight away going to the chapter now. I would like, if Jishu would start reading, please. This much that is shown over here.
Writing in a diary is a really strange experience for someone like me. Not only because I have never written anything before, but also because it seems to me that later on neither I nor anyone else will be interested in the musing of a 13 years old schoolgirl. Oh, well, it does not matter. I feel like writing, and I have an even greater need to get all kinds of things off my chest.
So what she's saying in the beginning of the prose that we have, she's saying that writing a diary is not very like me. She is not used to write a diary, okay? Not only because I've written anything before, she's saying not only because of the reason that I have not written anything before, but because of also the fact that I know nobody will be interested in reading the musing. What is the meaning of the word musing? All of you can write down in your notebook the first word that we are getting, one of the first word that we have got is in the introduction, and the second word that we are getting is musing, M-U-S-I-N-G. You can all see the word over here, M-U-S-I-N-G. Musing means a thought or reflection, a period of thought or reflection. It means a period of thought or reflection, thoughts or reflection. So she's saying nobody in the future would be very much interested in reading the thoughts or reflection of a mere school girl. And what is her age? She is only 13, just entered her adolescence or teenage. 13 is just the age when she has entered her teenage. So she is of the idea, look at her maturity, that nobody would be able to nobody would be interested to read whatever are the thoughts and ideas of a school girl. And then she said, oh, well, it doesn't matter. I feel like writing. I have an even greater need to get all kinds of things off my chest. Off my chest means all kind of things off my chest. Please underline this sentence. All kind of things off my chest. It may even come as a RTC or a reference to the context from this story. To get all kinds of things off my chest. It means to push away all the burdens or all the worries or all the thoughts that I have that have been troubling me from my mind, out of my mind. Whenever we feel very much depressed, hum log kya kehte hain, seene pe jaise bojh hai, seene pe jaise bojh hai. Hindi mein to aise hi kehte hain na. Similarly, the girl is saying that I want all kind of things off my chest. That means she wants to remove all the tensions, all the worries and all the important worries that are disturbing her out from her mind by writing the diary, by writing all those things down in that diary. Okay, next, please, Ishita, would you read, please?
Paper has more patience than people. I thought of this saying on one of those days when I was feeling a little depressed and was sitting at home with my chin in my hands, bored and listless, wondering whether to stay in or go out. I finally stayed where I was, brooding. Yes, paper does have more patience. And since I'm not planning to let anyone else read this stiff back notebook, grandly referred to as a diary, unless I should ever find a real friend, it probably won't make a bit of difference. Now, I'm back to the point that prompted me to keep a diary in the first place. I don't have a friend.
Okay. So what did you say that paper, this also can come as a, please underline this sentence also, this may also come as a reference to the context. Paper has more patience than people. Why does paper has more patience than people? What do you think? Can anybody just answer why she has said Ma'am. Paper has more patience than people? Yes, please.
Ma'am, kisi paper kuch jaldi jaldi
bole English, hai English, Shivam, ma'am. Shivam, would you please say in English?
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, paper will not force us to give me all information about yourself. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, any more points anyone want to add? Okay. I'll just tell you my point of view. Whenever we are talking to a person, or maybe a friend, or maybe a family member, or maybe someone we are acquainted to those person, that person may have a judgmental views on you. But paper cannot judge you because it is inanimate. Inanimate means non-living. That is why paper is not going to tell you that don't do this. Don't say this kind of words. Don't tell me all these things. I cannot bear with your thoughts. You are always brooding like this. Paper cannot come up with these things. When you are talking to a friend about your personal problems, the friend can come up with, aur kitna bolega bhai, abhi to abhi itna bola, aur bhi bolta jayega, ek hi cheez se bolta jata. The paper is not going to judge you like this. Obviously, friends are also always there for you. But sometimes writing your own feelings down is a different kind of feeling. I thought of saying no one of these those days when I was feeling a little depressed and was sitting at home with my chin on my hand. What is chin on my hand? Chin on my hand is sitting with the chin resting on the palm of your hand. Okay. Bored and listless, wondering whether to stay in or go out. She was confused whether to stay inside or to go out. I finally stayed where I was. Finally, she decided to stay inside. And I was brooding. Brooding means lost in different kind of thoughts, which are usually due to anger and depression. That is called brooding. This is another word I think you should write it down. The third word that we are getting that you should write down in your notebook. Brooding, B-R-O-O-D-I-N-G. Brooding means showing or getting engaged in different kinds of thoughts, showing or getting engaged in different kinds of thoughts, which makes one angry or depressed, showing or getting engaged in different kind of thoughts, which makes one angry or depressed. Okay, that is called a brooding state. Whenever you brood, you are thinking or showing engagement about something that can make you angry, that can make you depressed. Yes, paper does have more patience and it can listen to you. Sometimes when you are telling your stories to friends and it's too long, the person opposite to you may sometimes get bored with your story. होता है ना कभी भी तुम्हारे फ्रेंड्स से बात करो, फ्रेंड्स बोर हो गए तुम्हारे स्टोरी सुन के, वो बोल रहे मेरे बात सुन यार, बहुत सुन लिया तेरे बात, तुम मेरे बात सुनो अभी. बट पेपर इज नॉट एवर गोइंग टू गेट बोर्ड. It has patience. Since I am not planning to let anyone else read this Steve Blacked notebook again, one second, I'll just give entry to whoever is there. Okay. So what happened over here, as the paper is having tremendous patience because the paper is not a living being, so the paper can bear the patience to look into or hear or listen to you. Since I'm not planning to let anyone else read this Steve-backed notebook, grandly referred to as a diary. Steve-backed notebook is the diary over here, unless I should ever find a real friend. She's saying, I am never ever going to make any people read this diary, because unless I find a real friend. That means she shows that she has many friends, but are not a real friend who can actually go and read this diary. That is what she refers over here. She is saying that I am never going to show this diary to anybody unless that person is a real friend. It probably won't make a bit of difference. Now I'm back to the point that prompted me to keep a diary at the first place. What is the reason? Why is she keeping a diary? Because she doesn't have a friend or a real friend. That is why she is going to keep a diary. Next, I want Shomudip to read, please. Shomudip, would you please? Shomudip, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, please.
Let me put it more clearly. Since no one will believe that a 13-year-old girl is completely alone in the world, and I am not. I have loving parents and 16-year-old sister.
Please make a note of this point. She was 13. Her sister was 16. Okay. She was 13. Her sister was 16. Okay. Yes. Please go on, Shomadi.
And there are about 30 people I can call friends. I have a family, loving aunts and good home. No. On the surface, I seem to have everything except my one true friend. And I think about when I am with friends is having a good time. I can't bring myself to talk about anything but ordinary everyday things. We don't seem to be able to get any closer, and that's the problem. Maybe it's my fault that we don't confide in each other. In any case, that's just how things are, and unfortunately, they are not liable to change. This is why I have started the diary.
So she is giving us in this paragraph, she is giving us one more reason. What was the first reason that why she is writing a diary? Because she doesn't have a friend. She is elaborating that reason of not having a friend again in this portion, in this paragraph. She is saying that no, it doesn't mean that I don't have any loving parents. I have a very loving parent. I have Edith Frank and I have Otto Frank, who are very loving parents, and I even have a 16 years old older sister who is also very loving, and there are 30 more people whom I can call friends. But the problem, and there are uncles and aunts, but whenever I talk to my friends, yes, I'm happy, but what I talk is about everyday things. But what I want to talk is something different, something like about more about life, more not about usual things but about the unusual things. And I feel that they are not ready to talk about such things ever. Say, for example, if you go to school and you tell one of your friends that yesterday I was reading about the child labor issue. So what do you think? What is your concept about child labor? What are the reasons behind it? So you can talk at least a few minutes, that is 1 to 2 minutes on this issue. And after that, you will go back to us classroom mein kya hua tha, us classroom mein us time pe fan nahin chal raha tha, and the everyday daily issues. You cannot sometimes relate to this issue issues to your friends, because that becomes very difficult for you to for the other people and also for you to relate. But Anne Frank is a very deeply rooted, insightful girl who is insightful, who looks into his or her own feelings and then reflects them through her own words. So Anne Frank, being such an insightful and intelligent little girl, she feels that her emotions, her thoughts are not getting enough exposure to her friends, and that is why she wants to make the change and start a diary. Next point is Arnab, would you read, please?
Yes, ma'am. To enhance the image of this long awaited friend in my imagination, I don't wait to join down the path in this diary the way most people would do, but I want the diary to be my friend, and I am going to call the friend Kitty, since no one would understand a word of my stories to Kitty. If I were to plug right in, I would better provide a brief sketch of my life, but much as I dislike doing so.
Okay. So what she is saying, that over here you can see the word Kitty written on her diary, and what is dear, this one is called dear in Dutch. Okay, so this is the word called Dear Kitty, which is actually in Anne's handwriting from her diary. And the top of the diary looks like this. It is still there in the museum. So this is the top of the diary, and this is how she wrote first time Dear Kitty. Kitty is the name that she gives to her diary. This is the original picture of how she wrote Dear Kitty, and this is the original picture of the cover of the diary. It has many times in many movies and in many stories been referred as the red and white checked diary. The red and white checked diary. And what she says is that, I am not going to write like anybody else. What I am going to do is, I am going to name the diary as a friend, as I am going to explain or elaborate my thoughts and just share my thoughts with my diary just as a true friend. That is why I am going to name the diary. You can very well relate to this naming of things of adolescence period. Even sometimes when in childhood, we used to have like several things, like there is a monkey, so let's name that monkey. There is a pet cat, let's name that pet cat. There is a doll, let's name that doll. So that's, this naming thing is very common in children, sometimes also in adults. I even name sometimes my books, my pens or something. So this is a very common feature of our mind, of naming something. Okay, so the Anne Frank over here is naming the diary Kitty. Since no one would understand a word of my stories to Kitty, if I were to plunge right in. Plunge means take a dip, plunging into the water. Plunge means suddenly going down is plunging, plunge. All of you please write down this word in your notebook so that you can again refer it as a new word that you have learned. It is jumping moving into something quickly or suddenly. Jumping or moving into something quickly or suddenly. Jumping or moving into something quickly or suddenly. Plunge is jumping or moving into something quickly or suddenly. So she is saying that I won't suddenly start writing. That is why I want to give a brief sketch of my life. I want to tell my diary a brief sketch of my life, as much as I dislike so. She is saying that I don't like giving my life sketch, but I'll have to do it because I just cannot plunge into it. Plunge means dive into it. Diving means jumping suddenly. Just jumping deep suddenly, plunge into it. Okay, so this is how she starts it. So now she is giving a brief sketch of her life. You can over here in this slide see the picture. The picture is little blurred because it is very old picture. This man over here is Otto Frank, and this is over here, this is Anne Frank over here. This woman over here is Edith Frank, and the woman who is back at the picture is actually her grandma. Okay, so I want Diporna to start reading this portion, please. Diporna, would you please read?
Yes, ma'am. My father, the most adorable father I have ever seen, didn't marry my mother till he was 36 and she was 25. My sister married...
All of you, one second, please mark all of you the age of age when her father and mother got married, when her father was 36 and when her mother was 25, they got married. Okay, next is, please read.
My sister Margot was born in Frankfurt in Germany in 1926. I was born on 12 June 1929. I lived in Frankfurt.
Important. I was born in is important. Margot's date is not that important. Just underline the date when Anne Frank was born. She was born on 12th June 1929. Okay. And where did she? She was born in Frankfurt. She lived in Frankfurt. Okay. Yes.
I lived in Frankfurt till I was 4. My father emigrated to Holland in 1933.
Holland. Yes, thank you.
In 1933, my mother, Edith Hollander Frank, went with him to Holland in September. While Margot and I were sent to Aachen to stay with our grandmother. Margot went to Holland in December. I followed in February. When I was plunked down on the table as a birthday present for Margot, I started right away at the Montessori Nursery School. I stayed there till I was 6, at which time I started in the first form. In the sixth form, my teacher was Miss Cuperus, the headmistress.
Wait, beta, wait. Let's stop here. Can you see my screen, beta?
Yes, ma'am.
Then why are you reading extra? Just wait. Okay. So we are having a small sketch of her family life. You can see in this picture, all of them are having such a beautiful smile. So imagining their life to be traumatic is a little bit difficult for us. But actually, they led a very traumatic life. So it is very important that we can feel the positivity of this picture. And we get to know that there is a father and mother who are very happy. And she has got a sister who has got who used to live with her after a definite age. And over here we get a word called plunked. I was plunked down on the table as a birthday present. Prompt means hitting abruptly. Plunked is hit abruptly. H-I-T, hit abruptly. Abrupt. R-U-P-T-L-Y. Abruptly means suddenly. Okay. Plunked is hit abruptly. That means I was kept on the table as a present for my strip sister abruptly on her birthday. Okay. That is...
Ma'am.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, put down in a casual way.
Put down in a casual way, but more abruptly. That means suddenly as a gift to the sister. Okay. Okay. And before that, before she was brought to live with her family, with her father, mother and sister, she used to live with her grandmother. That is why her grandmother had a tremendous influence or tremendous impact in her life. Even after the death of her grandmother, we find her saying, even in the whole novel, if you read, we find her saying about her grandmother many a times, because being an adolescent girl, usually childhood memories and childhood personalities who influence a lot remain in their mind forever. Okay, so what happens next? You can over here see a picture of Anne Frank's Montessori school. You can see the circled one is Anne over here, and there is also a teacher sitting over here. So this is the Montessori school of Anne Frank. It seems like your class one classes, right? Just like
it was nursery school.
It's a Montessori or the nursery school where Anne Frank used to read. You can see the circled girl over here. She is Anne Frank over here. Don't you feel it's similar to the arrangement is same as your class one or the junior sections, like you used to sit round chairs and yes. tables, right? So now please, next, who would read? Who would read, please? I think Jivantika, would you read?
I started right away at the Montessori nursery school. I stayed there until I was 6, at which time I started in the first form. In the 6th form, my teacher was Mrs. Kepelas, the headmistress. At the end of the year, we were both in tears. We said a heartbreaking farewell. In the summer of 1941, Grandma fell ill and had to have an operation. So my birthday passed with little celebration.
Okay. Now I want you people to remember your own childhood days, the primary section. Which teachers do you remember the most from the primary section? I would also like to know, which are the teachers when you were leaving the primary section, you were very much depressed about leaving those teachers? Are there any teachers whom you adore, whom you admire a lot in the primary sections? The teachers have all changed. I know most of the teachers have changed because in KV, the teachers get transferred, the teacher retires. So there are many other problems. But still, do you remember any name?
Yes, ma'am.
It was heartbreaking for little Anne because she loved that teacher. Whenever we have a bonding with some person, leaving that person becomes very much heartbreaking. So what is the name of the teacher over here? The name of the teacher, as you said, yours is Meena ma'am. The name of Anne's teacher is Mrs. Cuperus. She was the headmistress and she was very dear to Anne. Even I remember one of my teachers from the primary section. She was, yes, Vita?
Meera ma'am.
So even I remember one of my teachers whose name was Mrs. Bose, and one of the most important incidents about her, which I remember, I would definitely share it with you, is she used to give us stars on top of the notebook if our handwriting is good. If your handwriting is very good, she used to give us 3 stars, the sparkling stars that we use on different kind of sticky stars, okay, stickers kind of things. So if your handwriting is very good, then your notebook is going to get 3 star. If it is good, then you're going to get 2 star. If it is okay, then you're going to get 1 star. So she once gave me 3 stars, but while returning home from the school, 2 of the stars fell away from my copy. And when I was showing that notebook to my mother was not ready to believe that I have got 3 star. And next day when my mother went to school to take me, usually my mother used to go to school to take me back, and Mrs. Bose said she has very good handwriting, she has got 3 stars. And then I remember the smile on my mother's face, and I was so proud and so happy with Mrs. Bose that she is saying this thing to my mother, which is making her smile. So these are the dependence, this is the bond of love that we have with the teachers, usually in the primary section, because then we feel that the teachers are our parents, because at that age we are not ready to leave our parents and go to school. So this is a very warm bonding that we usually possess with the primary teachers. That is why Anne still remembers the name of Mrs. Cuperus. Okay. Next, what she is saying, in the summer of 1941, Grandma fell ill. See, the mention of Grandma is over there, 1941, and she is writing the diary in which year? Can anybody tell me which is the year when she is writing the diary? In
1941.
Yes. So she is referring to an incident which is before 1 year. So 1 year before, Grandma fell ill. So my birthday passed with little celebration. If somebody in the family is ill and not well, obviously you cannot celebrate your birthday. So she is a little sad about the fact that her birthday could not be celebrated due to Grandma being ill. Okay. Next is, please, now you can see over here the picture of Anne's grandma, and this little infant baby on grandma's lap is actually Anne, and this is Margot. Okay, so this is Margot, this is grandma, and this is our little Anne. Okay, so Cheyenne, would you read this one, please, this portion, Cheyenne? put the microphone off. The rest of you, Shayan would only put the microphone on.
Grandma died in January 1942. No one knows how often I think of her and still love her. This birthday celebration is in 1942 was intended to make up for the other, and Grandma's candle was lit along with the rest. The four of us are still doing well, and that brings me to the present date of 20 June 1942 and this solemn dedication.
Solemn
dedication of my diary.
Okay. So what she is saying is that, one second, somebody's microphone is on, please put the microphone off. Okay, so she is saying that Grandpa died in 1942 in January. The grandma died in 1942 January. Okay, and when is Anne's birthday? It is on June, right? We have learned that Anne's birthday is in June. So no one knows, often I think of her and still love her. This sentence is very important. You can underline this sentence. This can also come as a reference to the context. No one knows how often I think of her and still love her. She's talking about grandma. And she's saying that I have kept it a secret that I still miss her and I still think about her. This birthday celebration in 1942, that means when she's becoming a 13 years old, was intended to make up for the other. What is make up for the other? It intended to be a compensation for the rest of the birthdays that she has not been able to celebrate, or the previous birthday that she has not been able to celebrate due to grandma's illness. And along with the candles on the birthday, along with the candles on the cake, grandma's candle, candle has also been lit in front of the picture of grandma. And she's saying four of us are still doing well. Please underline this line also. It is very important. The four of us are still doing well. There is a slight sarcasm over here. Still. The word still is very much sarcastic. Why is she saying still? Because we all know after this, their life is going to be different. And also the use of still is there because she is starting to write over there. So if we take it from our perspective, this still, the word still, gives us a slight tinge in our mind that something may go wrong afterwards. And from her point of view, when she is writing, she is saying still because she is writing the diary then. And now from here, she is starting to dedicate the diary. Solemn means dignified or formal. Please, all of you, write down the meaning of solemn. The pronunciation is solemn. N is silent. Solemn. S-O-L-E-M-N. Solemn. Okay, please, all of you, write down this word in your notebook. The word is solemn. S-O-L-E-M-N. Solemn. Solemn means formal or dignified. Formal. Usually, over here, we can say formal dedication of my diary. Formal. Formal means solemn. Okay, please don't say that formal dress is solemn dress. That's not the correct use. Solemn is usually used for some dedication, for some speaking purpose, all this kind of thing. Formal dress is not called a solemn dress. Please remember that. Okay, so we are now starting the diary. Okay, so I want, who would read? Jibantika, have you read? Jibantika has read. Maitri, would you start reading, please?
Saturday, 20 June 1942. Dearest Kitty.
Please underline this date, all of you. This is the most important date because over here in the picture also you can see, though it is written in Dutch, you won't be able to understand, but you can see dates were written like this. On top of the diary, the dates were written like this. So please underline this date. This has come as a short question, that when did she start writing the diary? Okay. Yes, please.
Okay. Our entire class is quacking in its boots. The reason, of course, is the forthcoming meeting in which the teacher decides who will move up to the next form and who will be kept back. Half the class is making bets. GN and I laugh ourselves silly at the two boys behind us. Cian and Jacques, who have stacked their entire holiday savings on their bed from morning to night. It's you're going to pass. No, I'm not. Yes, you are. No, I'm not. Even just pleading glances and my angry outburst can't calm them down. Calm them down. If you ask me, there are so many dummies that about a quarter of the class should be kept back, but teachers are the most unpredictable creatures on earth.
Okay, now from here you can relate your own story with Anne's life, your life with Anne's life. Don't you have such conversations in class when you're sitting, such situations in class when you're sitting in a bench and two of the backbenchers are quarreling about sometimes? Even I have seen in your class, okay, I have seen that, what is the name, that the two twins, what are their names, the name of the two twins, Ritesh and
Ritabrata and Devabrata
talking about something continuously. They're talking. And then if you're sitting in the front of them and you are wanting to concentrate or wanting to talk about something else, you get frustrated with it. And you just give them a glance and sometimes call them, what you are doing? Can't you just stop? You just say this kind of, subah se baki ja rahe hai, bhai chup kar ja. So this kind of things happen in class. Whenever, so the girl is saying there are many dummies in the class. Dummies means something that is a representation, a false representation. A dummy artist. Who is a dummy artist? Who is a false representation of the actual artist? A copy. So she is saying there are many dummies in this class. They are not actual students. They pose to be students. Okay. Dummies are false representation. Okay. So she is saying that, and these people are like they don't have any sense. This was the day when the result is going to be out, and the teachers are going to decide who are going to go to the next class and who are going to stay back. And she's saying, if you ask me, half of the quarter of the class should stay back because all of them are very dumb. So we can see over here a topper like attitude, or a smart girl's attitude over here. We can see from her writing and from her face, her smile, it is so bright, it is so genuine, it is so insightful, that she must be a topper or a very smart girl in the class. And she's saying, if the teachers ask me, I would say the quarter of the class should be staying back because they are all dummies. They don't deserve to be going up. And what are the two names that we, if we take it as Ritabrata and Devabrata, Anne's version is CN and Jacques. Okay, CN and Jacques were the people who were baiting on the fact that you are going to pass or you're not going to pass. And the whole day round, they were only saying, you are going to pass. And the other person is saying, no, I'm not. Then the other person is again saying, yes, you are. So you would obviously get frustrated with if somebody goes on with the continuous things like this. And you can see in the first line, it is said, our entire class is quaking in the boots. Quaking means making a noise and vibration. Making a noise and vibration. Quaking is making a noise and vibration with your shoes. That is like tapping the shoes continuously. Okay, that is the entire class is tapping the shoes to make a sound and vibration with their boots. Okay, that is quaking of shoes. And what is the day that she is referring to in the first entry? She is referring to the day when they are going to be promoted to the next class. And how does she end this paragraph? She is saying that though I think most of the people should be staying back, but teachers are the most unpredictable creatures on earth. Teachers cannot be predicted. Yes, obviously, sometimes, I don't know, could you predict me? Ishita, what do you think? I am predictable or I'm not predictable? Okay, let Sahil answer this.
I'm not predictable.
That means I'm unpredictable. Sahil, what do you think? I'm unpredictable or predictable? Sahil?
I'm predictable.
Predictable, okay. Sahil can predict me. That's nice. Okay.
So, I'm handy.
friendly, okay? I would just stop the discussion right away because too much of information and you will forget everything. I'll just give you a small revision on the whole topic and we will end the slideshow over here and we will move on to the next part of the story the next day. Let's have a quick revision of the whole thing and I would just give you time to ask me a few questions if you have, okay? I'm escaping this and I'll just give you a quick revision. From the first slide, we have read whatever we are going to learn. In the next slide, we have read about the World War and the Holocaust. Next slide, we have an idea that where this piece has been taken from. We have read about the various characters. We have read about the language in which the story was written. Next, we have read about when the story has been written and when has it been published. Can you see 1947 means the same year when India got independence? Okay, next is we have started with the story and 1 second. Now somebody is asking for admit. No, thank God. We have come to know that why she wants to write the diary. Excuse me, Mausam, why are you joining now? Mausam?
Ma'am, game khelta rehta har samay.
Okay, Mausam, I want to talk to your parents. Today only in the afternoon, I'll call your parents. I'm just writing down the name. Every time you're joining so late every day.
Computer mein game khelta hai.
Yes, Mausam, let him say, please, what was the reason to join so late?
Ma'am, mera net nahi aa raha tha. Abhi main Wi-Fi se on kiya to link hi nahi aa raha tha. Abhi data on kiya tabhi link aaya.
Beta, data on pehle karna chahiye tha na? The classes are important. I won't be giving attendance to you for this class for this few minutes. I won't give you attendance for this. This is the ending of the class. I've discussed everything. So what is the meaning of joining the class right now? You should have tried out this means previously, right? Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So please keep that in mind from the next class. Let's come back. So we have read why she is writing the diary through two of the slides. And in the next slide, we have read about a short life sketch that we have, that how old she is, who are the family members, and what is the name that she is going to give to the diary. What are the other names of the family members, how old they are. All of us have read about them. Even she has told us about her Montessori school or the nursery school and the name of one of her teachers, Mrs. Cuperus, and even told that her grandma was ill in 1941 and in 1942 she died. And that is the date in 1942, 20th June, that she's starting to write her diary. And she's telling us about an incident when they are being promoted to the next class and the teachers are supposed to decide who is going to be promoted. And please put the microphones off, who is going to be promoted and who is not going to be promoted. Okay, so this was a quick revision. I'll come back to the screen. I'll stop sharing the screen. I'll just stop also the recording. Just wait for a second. I'll stop the recording.